Good morning, everybody. In the next 45 minutes, we are going to speak about some principles in neuropharmacology. And I wish that with my talk, I can encourage some of the students that may involve in drug discovery projects now or in the future, that they persist in such a challenging task. Because as you will see, we are really much in need of new medicines for brain diseases. So we are going to see a bit of basics in neuropharmacology. So what it is pharmacodynamics and receptor binding, pharmacokinetics, and the importance of the blood-brain barrier. And then we will see the neuropharmacology trends, so what it is, the drug development, how are the drug development programs organized, and which are the Food and Drug Administration approvals in the last 50 years. So the neuropharmacology goal, as you know, is to apply information about drugs and their mechanisms of action to find more effective treatments for diseases that are affecting nervous system and producing abnormalities. The classification of neuropharmacology is very various, and here you can see some of the branches: neuropharmacology, psychopharmacology, behavioral neuropharmacology, molecular neuropharmacology, and all of them are going to deal with finding new drugs and how did these drugs affect the human body. So this is the pharmacodynamics that is going to deal with the action of drugs on a living body and which are the biochemical and physiological effects that these drugs have on the body depending on the concentration. When the drugs are entering the body, they can affect, as you may know, different kinds of targets, and these go from receptors where the drugs can act as agonists or antagonists. We will see later more in detail. They can affect or modulate ion channels, and then they can block the permeation of the channel, blocking the passing through of the ions, or they can be modulators, increasing or decreasing the opening probability. They can modulate enzymes, so mainly as inhibitors that inhibit the catalytic reaction, or they can affect as well transporters, inhibiting the normal transport of metabolites through the membrane. When the drugs deal with the nervous system, they are called neuropharmacologic agents, and they can modulate the peripheral nervous system or the central nervous system. And the mechanism of action is going to be through modulating the axonal conduction, and in this case they are going to be quite non-selective drugs because the axon in the neurons is similar, and this is the case of some local anesthetics. Or they can modulate the synaptic transmission, and in this case they are going to be highly selective drugs depending on which population of neurons are affecting or which kind of receptors. So here you can see schematically represented different processes that can be modulated by drugs. So for example, this step here, the transmitter synthesis from precursor to transmitter, or for example here the release from the transmitter from the presynaptic neuron into the synapse, or this other step here, the receptor binding of the neurotransmitter in the receptor of the postsynaptic membrane. And this other step here can also be affected, that is the reuptake of the neurotransmitter from the synapse. So we are going to go a bit in detail to this step here, the receptor binding. And receptor binding is a chemical reaction that is going to be specific, saturable, and stereoselective. And it's a reaction between a ligand and a receptor. And it comes, so it is usually described by the law of mass action, where a ligand binds a receptor, and this reaction goes on until reaching the equilibrium with the formation of the ligand-receptor complex. And here there are two constants that are defining this reaction, that is the K-on rate constant and K-off. And this model of reaction has some, is a bit reductionist, because one is assuming that all the receptors are going to be in the same conformation, and one is assuming, for example, that the ligand is not going to be degraded in the course of the reaction. So important parameters in the reaction are going to be the KD, and this is the dissociation constant, that is the quotient between the K-off and the K-on. And another important parameter is going to be the fractional occupancy, that is the amount of bound receptor in reference to the total receptors that are present. So in lay language, or when we are speaking about receptors, what it is important about the KD is that it is the inverse of the affinity. Yeah? So the affinity is the ability of a drug to bind a receptor site, and it is going to be defined as the concentration of drug required to occupy 50% of the sites at equilibrium. The Vmax is the total amount of binding, and it is usually found by extrapolation of the curves that we are getting in the receptor binding reaction. So this is an example of one of these experiments, the kind of graphics that probably you have seen already that we are getting. And this is a hyperbolic curve. When the concentration of radioactive ligand is increasing, this is the specific binding that we are obtaining. Yeah? So this point here, where the occupancy of the receptors is half of the maximal value, this point here will be the KD. And this will be the Vmax that one can get by extrapolation, and for example, doing a linearization of this graphic and scatter plot, and it will be this point here. So what it is important is that in the receptor binding reactions, we get information of what is doing the receptor, what is doing the ligand on the receptor, but we are not getting information on the receptor function. So when we do the receptor binding reactions, one is getting the total binding, and of course one has to take into account the non-specific binding. This is that the drug can bind to other places in the membrane that are not receptor sites. And this has to be subtracted, and like this we get a Landmuir representation, like the one that we have seen in the previous slide. In some papers you can see as well this kind of representation, so it's simply doing the logarithmic scale here, and then one get a sigmoidal curve, and this will be the KD value. And when one is doing, instead of reactions with a purified receptor and a ligand, or a membrane preparation and a ligand, instead of that, when one is doing cell assays, for example, what one is getting here is a response. And then, in this case, this parameter will be the stimulatory concentration 50, or in the case that we are dealing with an inhibitor, this point here is giving us the inhibitory concentration 50. So other terms that are important in receptor binding is, for example, the potency of the drugs, and this allows us to compare different kind of drugs in an assay. So for example, if we are comparing drug A with drug D, this will be the strength, how A is binding to the receptor, and this will give us the 50% of the response with drug D, so then drug A will be more potent than drug D. Efficacy is another important parameter in binding, and is the maximal biological effect that one agonist can give. And if we compare all these drugs, all of them have the same stimulatory concentration, 50, but we are reaching different activity with each of them. And we can see then that A has a higher efficacy than D. Another two important terms are selectivity and specificity. And selectivity makes reference if a drug is binding only to one receptor or to several receptors. And this is going to be in relation with the therapeutic window that we are going to see next. And specificity is when one drug is able to alter one disease process without altering others. So here you have, as an example, yohimbine, that is an alkaloid, that in the concentration between 10 and 100 nanomolar is selective for alpha-2 adrenoceptors, and it can block them. But if one is starting to increase the concentration, it loses the selectivity, so in this case it's going to start binding to other receptors, and it's also losing the specificity because it's producing other effects, like for example here it's producing complete the opposite effect when the concentration is increasing and binding to the alpha-1 adrenoceptors. How are the receptor binding reactions done? Classically, one used to do these reactions with such a machine, and these were radioactive assays. The machine is called Cell Harvester, and we were having cell membrane preparations. One was giving the radioactive ligand, and then one was filtrating and measuring the radioactivity that was bound to the membranes. Nowadays, not many laboratories are using that. They are using non-radioactive assays like surface plasmon resonance. This is giving the binding of a ligand to a protein in real time. So what we do is that we are immobilizing a protein in chips, and then we are passing through the ligand, and this is going to give you in real time the constants. Other kind of assays is FRET or fluorescent polarization. And one can see as well receptor binding in vivo, for example, by positron emission tomography. And one is seeing here, for example, the activity, so the red areas are is glucose metabolism and is related to the activity of the brain. So there are a broad range of ligands, depending on what they are doing in the receptor. They can be classified as full agonist, and these ligands bind to the receptor and initiate the cellular process, and they are usually the endogenous ligands, for example, gamma-aminobutyric acid when it binds to the GABA receptors. Superagonists are usually synthetic drugs, and one is getting a higher efficacy than with endogenous agonists. One example would be the synthetic superagonist of vitamin D nuclear receptors. Partial agonists bind to the receptor, but they produce less cellular activity than the agonist. And one example will be gaboxadol, that is a hypnotic that is binding to GABA receptor. And then we have the antagonist, which have affinity for the receptor, but they don't stimulate it. So the antagonist can be competitive when they compete with the agonist for the binding site. And in this way, they can be reversible or irreversible. The irreversible ones usually bind to the receptor and they dissociate very slow, or they don't dissociate at all because they can form covalent bonds. And the antagonism can be as well non-competitive when the antagonist binds reversibly to the receptor, but to another place different than the agonist. And in this case, it will be an allosteric binding. We are going to see the curves that represent the antagonist reactions. So this will be the curve that we are getting with the agonist. And in the case of a reversible competitive antagonism, when we increase the concentration of antagonist, the curve is displaced to the right, but increasing the concentration of agonists, we get the same fractional occupancy. In the case of an irreversible competitive antagonism, as you can see, then this fractional occupancy cannot be recuperated when we increase the concentration of agonist. There are two more kinds of ligands. The inverse agonist have opposite effect to the agonist, and they produce a negative efficacy, and therefore there has to be some constitutive activation of the receptor. This is the case of the convulsant benzodiazepines that bind to the receptor GABA A, but they are not going to have clinical use because they are convulsant. And allosteric modulators, which bind to sites in the receptor other than the agonist site and modify the agonist activity. And this will be, for example, the case of the benzodiazepines. So we see now here how the allosteric modulators are working, the kind of curves that one can get with the allosteric modulators are when they are modulating here the agonist, and then they produce a negative affinity, and then we have a displacement of the curve to the right, or a positive affinity modulation, and then they displace it to the left, and they can happen the same with the efficacy. So that you get an idea of how complex can be the receptor binding. Here you have, for example, the GABA A receptor. That is a ligand-gated ion channel, is postsynaptic and pentameric. And then the endogenous agonist is gamma-aminobutyric acid that reduces excitability when it allows the chloride ions to pass through the channel. And then you see that there is a broad range of ligands that can bind to this receptor. So, for example, muscimol is an agonist from mushroom that has sedative and hypnotic properties, and then it binds to the GABA receptor site. Bicuculin is an antagonist, convulsant, and produces epilepsy, and then it binds to the same agonist receptor site. Benzodiazepines are positive allosteric modulators with anticonvulsant and sedative properties, and then they bind to this other allosteric site here. Flumazenil is a benzodiazepine antagonist that is used in the overdose of benzodiazepines, and it binds also here. Beta-carboline is an inverse agonist that intensifies anxiety, and picrotoxin is a channel blocking with convulsant properties that binds here. So you see that in the same receptor there are many kinds, several kinds of ligands or of drugs that can bind. Even there are others like ethanol, barbiturates, and anesthetic agents that combine as well to the receptor. So it's a very promiscuous receptor. So we have seen now what the drugs are doing in the receptors in the body, in the targets that they are reaching. And now we are going to see what is pharmacokinetics, that is, how a living body acts on the drugs. And it deals with the measurement of changes of drug concentration in blood plasma a long time. And this is going to be depending on the next processes that are absorption, metabolism, distribution, and excretion. So probably you have heard already of ADME studies. And these are the ones that are dealing with absorption, or how is the delivery route of the drug in the body, with the distribution of the drug in the body, so which organs are going to reach, with the metabolism, or how the drug is going to be transformed in the body, and with the excretion or elimination of the drug after the whole process has happened. So all these absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion is going to influence the bioavailability of a drug in the body, that is, how much of the drug that is administered is going at the end to reach its target. So bioavailability, it depends on the route of administration, on the dose that we are giving, on the onset of action, on the peak of action time and duration, on the frequency of dosing, and all these parameters are going to be important in the drug discovery process in clinical studies to know about the therapeutic effect of a drug in comparison to when it is appearing the adverse effects of this drug. You can see here the representation of several curves of different routes of administration. So in time, it is represented how the drug concentration in blood is increasing. And then you can observe, for example, that with intravenous administration, we get a very fast increase of drug in the blood in the beginning, but it goes very fast down. And with oral administration, for example, the drug reaches the blood later on in time, but it stays there for a longer period. So this will be a representative curve for oral administration, even when it is looking a bit different than here. It depends on the drug, of course, and with the different steps, absorption, when it is going from the intestines into the blood, distribution into the different organs and metabolism in the liver, and later on elimination through the kidneys. And these kind of curves are described mathematically by the Bateman function. Important in pharmacokinetics are the properties of the drug. So for example, the lipid water partition coefficient, and this is going to give us an indication of how hydrophobic or hydrophilic a drug is. If it binds to plasma protein, and how is going to be the stability of the drug once absorbed. One important parameter also is if the drug is going to be able to cross the blood-brain barrier. This is important in neuropharmacology. And the blood-brain barrier, as you know, is a highly selective permeability barrier that separates the circulating blood from the brain extracellular fluid in the central nervous system. And here you have a representation of how it is looking. So these are the capillaries where the blood is going, and they are formed, also they are delimited by endothelial cells and pericytes. And here there is the basal lamina that is contacting with some astrocytes. And the blood-brain barrier is able to keep the homeostasis in the brain and is able to allow to some metabolites to pass through, but is also able to keep some drugs out of the brain. So in detail, it's looking like this. Some metabolites can pass through by passive diffusion. This will be the case of the water-soluble agents and lipid-soluble agents. And some metabolites are using specialized transporters, like is the case of glucose, amino acids, and nucleosides. These transporters can work something in the opposite direction, like it will be the case of pig glycoprotein and multidrug resistant protein, and what they do is to pump out drugs or toxic compounds out of the brain. Some transport is done through receptor mediated transcytosis. This is the case of insulin and transferrin. And other transport is absorptive transcytosis that is a bit less selective than the receptor-mediated transcytosis because it's depending on the charge of the drugs. Yeah? So positively charged molecules bind the negative membrane and then they can pass through to the other side. So as Partridge described, it is very important that 98% of small molecules do not cross the blood-brain barrier, and 100% of the molecules that are big, this means peptides or small molecules that are bigger than 1 kilodalton, do not cross the blood-brain barrier. And when one is working in drug discovery, it seems that we are not paying too much attention to the fact that less than 1% of the companies are dealing with blood-brain barrier programs, and the same is happening in academy. So then there is a lot to be done here. When we are discovering drugs, we have to take care of that. So to improve the delivery of drugs into the brain, one can make use of physiological delivery. This will mean to modify the drug in a way that is using endogenous nutrient transporters, and this is the case of L-DOPA that is transported via the large neutral amino acid carriers, or via receptor-mediated transcytosis, and this means to modify the molecule with a ligand or with an antibody, and then these are recognizing the transferrin insulin or LDL receptors, and then they are like this passing through. Or one can do a pharmacological delivery. This means one can modify the drug, decreasing the drug size, so you know when the drugs are 500, 300 kilodaltons, they have higher probability to pass through. Increasing the lipophilicity, this will be related to the log P, that is the coefficient that we have seen of water organic phase partition. Linking the drug to a lipophilic carrier and delivering as a prodrug, or increasing the stability and solubility via micelles and polymers. Another way that one can make use of is blocking the active efflux of P glycoproteins that the drug is not exported again, or disrupting the blood-brain barrier temporarily, and this is done by osmotic pressure, for example, with mannitol. One is injecting mannitol in the patients, and then the endothelial cells are separating a bit, and then one is using this time window to inject other, for example, chemotherapeutics in the case of brain cancer. And this is used in already in some university hospitals like in Oregon. So until here we have seen a bit on pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics, and we are going to see now how are the neuropharmacology trends and the food and drug administration approvals. You should know that in 2009, from around 11,000 clinical trials, 250 only were targeting depression, and more than 5,500 oncology indications. And it is not that oncology, it is not important that it is, but the numbers for neurological diseases and in general diseases that are affecting the nervous system are big. So, for example, 6.7% of people in the United States are affected by depression, and 50 million of Americans are affected by neurological disorders. Approximately a sixth or having described 600 neurological disorders, and these are producing an 8% in the global health burden. So the process of drug development, maybe you are familiar with it, is a very costly project. So it can reach until $1.4 billion. And it is not only resources consuming, it's as well a very time consuming project, because it can last until 12 years in total. And it has a very high attrition rate. This means that we are starting in the beginning with a big amount of potential compounds that are affecting a disease, and we are ending at the end with only one drug. And this process has a lot of work to be developed, for example, in the discovery phase, where one has to discover a target and then produce some hits, and from the hits to produce a lead drug. From there on, one has to optimize it and then to start the preclinical development in mice. At this stage is, for example, very important the formulation in neuropharmacology, because not all the patients are going to be able to comply with oral administration, and one has to see the drug can be injected or supplied in any other way. And then it comes all this development part where the clinical studies are done, and it is the most costly part because it is including quite some patients, mainly in the last stages. So, very important in the whole process is the moment where one is going to do the patent filing, because the patent time is going to be 20 years. And then if one is doing it very very early in the process, then these 20 years are already running on, and the companies are not getting so much money as they were investing. Anyone is doing too late, then it can happen that other companies are taking advantage and then developing a similar drug before. So we are going to go a bit in detail in these phases here. In the discovery phase, as we have told, is very important the target discovery and validation. So one has to look for a protein or a receptor that can be affected in the disease. And one has to evaluate its potential as target. One has to design bioassays to measure the biological activity. Perform the high throughput or screening or medium size screening to find the hits. And once one has found the hits, one has to go to the lead development by medicinal chemistry. And in this process here, these parameters that we have already seen are going to be important to describe the first hits that one is discovering. Later on, it comes the preclinical phase. So these are the animal studies, and they are necessary before getting permission by the EMEA or the FDA to continue with human studies. And in this part here, one has to do the pharmacological testing, what it is called the safety pharmacology. One has to demonstrate that there are no cardiac dysrhythmias, blood pressure changes, or ataxia in the animals. Then one has to do a preliminary toxicological testing, where one is testing the maximum non-toxic dose for 28 days in two species, and then one has to do a post-mortem analysis of the animals to demonstrate that there are no histological or biochemical signs of damage. Then one has to do the pharmacokinetics testing to link the pharmacological and toxicological effects to the plasma concentration of the drug. And then one has to do the chemical and pharmacological development to see if the molecule that has been synthesized in a small scale in the laboratory, if this can be scaled up and one can do a big synthesis of it, besides checking the stability and the formulation of the drug. In the preclinical phase, these are going to be important parameters. So the lethal dose 10%, that is the dose that causes death in 10% of the animals tested. And this used to be LD50, but nowadays we are paying very much attention to the 3 R's, the replacement, reduction, and refinement of animal testing. Then another parameter is the median toxic dose, or dose at which or above 50% of the animals tested had toxic effects. And then the ED50 or median effective dose, that is the minimum dose to show the desired activity in half the members of a population after a certain time. And these parameters are going to be important to define the therapeutic index of a drug. And the farther away that are these two curves, then the safer that is going to be the medication. The last stages of the drug development program is the clinical phase. Like we have seen, it is the most costly part, mainly because the number of patients are increasing until the end. So each of the phases is going to be defined by an endpoint. So for example, in phase 1, safety, in phase 2, efficacy, in phase 3, efficacy, phase 4, efficacy in long term. Then they are going to have specific points depending on what we are asking from the drug. For example, here it will be cardiac output if we are looking for a heart drug. And then there are different types of studies that we will not go in detail. Probably you already have heard of open, single blinded, double blinded, prevention, etc. So once a drug has reached this point, then it is when it is going to be then finally marketed. Yeah? And then we end with drugs like these ones that probably you are familiar already with, For example, in between anesthetics, you have heard of propofol, from analgesic drugs, opiates, in antidepressant drugs, for example, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors and tricyclic antidepressants are important. We are going to see a bit afterwards. In cognition enhancers, for example, rivastigmine, that we will see now also. So you have to know that since the 50s, the FDA has approved in psychiatric disorders only 78 new molecular entities. This is not much. And the prevalent indications were mainly depression, schizophrenia, anxiety, followed by addiction and psychosis. And the targets that these drugs were reaching were, with much difference, GPCRs and GPCR receptors and transporters. In the case of neurological disorders, there were also approved only 79 new molecular entities, and the main prevalent indications were seizures, including epilepsy, and Parkinson's disease, followed by neuromuscular diseases. And here as well, GPCR receptors and channels were the main targets that were studied. And very importantly, there is here a part of drugs which mechanism of action is unclear, even when they are effective. So if one is looking at the average of new molecular entities in the last 70 years, one can see that this has been more or less one approval per year. This is the case in psychiatric disorders, but the average is the same for neurological disorders. And this is a bit surprising because one would expect maybe something like that, taking into account that we are investing nowadays many more resources and that they are available many more tools, different biological and experimental tools that they were not having available in the 50s. So one could wonder why this is like this, and there are some reasons for it. Some of them is that the small molecule library's composition is biased for GPCR receptors and channels, so the first medications that were found were for these kind of receptors, and then by looking for similar molecules, it has been enriching this kind of, so the libraries have been enriching this kind of small molecules. There are more inhibitors and antagonists than agonists that have been developed, for example, this is another bias. From 15 agonists that, from 15 agonists that have been approved, 7 impact the GABA A receptor. And from 20 reuptake inhibitors, 13 modulate the serotonin transporter. So there is also a bias for this kind of pathways, the GABA A and the receptor and the serotonin transporter. And another problem is that the animal models that are available is very reduced. So one should maybe work a bit more in this direction. In the case of neurodegenerative diseases, that you know that they are conditions characterized by progressive cell loss and production and accumulation of misfolded proteins, the pathophysiological events are here summarized, and the illnesses are, so the diseases are starting long time before the behavioral phenotype and the cognitive phenotype is clinically recognized. And in this case, the kind of medications that are available are symptomatic antidementia agents and psychotropic drugs that are affecting the steps already here very downstream. But, but we are missing disease-modifying agents. So for all this part here, at the moment, there is still no drug that it is active. So why this may happen? The problem is that central nervous system diseases are very complex, and maybe one cannot target only single molecules, single proteins or receptors. So central nervous system disorders are polygenic with environmental and epigenetic components. And animal models to validate drug discovery are very few, or they are very complicated. And besides, there is not the possibility of tissue availability for biopsies and analysis. So maybe drugs that target more than one receptor are going to be better drugs. So what it has been called dirty drugs. One example for this is the case of antidepressants. So if one is comparing different antidepressants with selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors that I was mentioning in the table before, then one can see that the efficacy, for example, of electroconvulsive therapy, which molecular target is undetermined, is greater efficacy than selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Imipramine, that is a tricyclic antidepressant, and that it targets norepinephrine transporter, serotonin transporter, and serotonin receptor, for example, has a slight advantage in reference. Venlafaxine, that targets these two transporters, has also a slight advantage. So then it is maybe that drugs that, as I have told already, target different kind of receptors are going to be are going to have more efficacy, higher efficacy. So how to develop the best non-selective drugs? In the last 20 years, mainly the different groups or companies were using high throughput screening, but this was used mainly for single molecular targets. Classically, one was using behavior-based screening, where one is looking at drug responses in entire organisms, and in this way, two new antidepressants have been found with these two very strange names, that they don't have any affinity for known targets, but that obviously they seem to work. One can follow genomic approaches, so it's the ability to modify the coordinated expression of gene families. So what one is doing is one is giving drugs that one knows that they are effective to the animals, and then one is doing a macro race to see which proteins are affected, and then one is trying to design drugs that are targeting directly those proteins, trying to leave the secondary, also the second effects, outside. And one can do a structure-based drug design using different molecular targets that have a high degree of similarity. And this approach is what it is called multi-target drug discovery, that you can see here in comparison with single target discovery. So it will be one drug that is able to affect several targets to reach the therapeutic effect. The only problem is that it can have also this end here, so it could have more side effects as one of the classical drugs. Just finishing, I want to show you the example of ladostigil for Alzheimer's disease, and is one of these multi-target drugs. So this is ladostigil, that is a composite of this molecule, rasagiline and rivastigmine, and this other molecule. This one is an inhibitor of acetylcholinesterase, and then what it does is increasing the amount of acetylcholine. And rasagiline is an inhibitor of monoamine oxidase B, and then it decreases the radical oxygen species concentration, and it increases dopamine, noradrenaline, and serotonin concentration. And it seems that this composite molecule presents very good activity and is very, very promising. So the conclusions of what I have told you is that the drug discovery process, mainly in neuropharmacology, is complicated. It's a multidisciplinary enterprise where one should integrate in silico, in vitro, and in vivo studies. That we need new targets in neuropharmacology, we need new chemical libraries, and very clearly new animal models, approaches that integrate behavioral, genomic, and medicinal chemistry studies, and more than nothing else, innovation. I wanted to show you the case of the last medicines that are in pipeline. some of them have been developed by biotechnology companies in contrast to the classical pharmaceutical companies. So what they are doing, biotechnology companies, they are developing more in the direction of peptides and antibodies, and maybe this could be one of the successful ways of doing it. Thank you very much.